Good afternoon, everyone, and a warm welcome to this webinar. So we are MedGenome, the leaders in genetic testing in India. The topic for today's webinar is on inborn errors of metabolism. This is a two-part webinar wherein we'll be talking. In the first part, we'll be talking about inborn errors of metabolism, what a clinician needs to know. And in the second part, which will be broadcast on the 12th of May, Tuesday, we will talk about next generation sequencing and its application in the diagnosis of inborn errors of metabolism. So the speaker for both these webinars is Dr. Sunita Bijarnia-Mahe, Senior Consultant and Genetic Metabolic Specialist at the Institute of Medical Genetics and Genomics at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Sunita graduated from Lady Harding Medical College, New Delhi. She did her DCH from Maulana Azad Medical College, New Delhi, and DNB in Pediatrics from Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. She went on to do her fellowship in genetic metabolic disorders from Sydney, Australia in 2008. And she has 19 years of experience and more than 75 publications in peer-reviewed journals and 5 chapters in various books on inborn errors of metabolism. She is the founding executive member of the National Coordination and National Coordinator of the Indian Society for Inborn Errors of Metabolism and founding executive member of Society of Fetal Medicine India. Her current research interests include organic acduries, molecular studies in Indian children, genetically determined leukodystrophies, mitochondriopathies, and other neurodegenerative disorders and disorders of homocysteine metabolism. We also have Dr. Sheeta Sharda with us, who's a senior consultant at MedGenome, who will pitch in with her insights at the end of the talk. So without any further delay, I will now transfer the host to Dr. Sunita, who will take this webinar forward.
Thank you, MedGenome, for giving me this opportunity to talk about inborn errors of metabolism to this august audience, because I know there are a lot of senior physicians as well in this group. So welcome to all with this session. I hope to do justice to the topic, although I know that it is such a vast topic that it's difficult to cover everything. So let me just get started. So we'll just be talking about, in this webinar, we'll talk about inborn errors of metabolism. We'll probably try and get some clues to how to recognize these disorders, and then go on to some clinical presentation types with a few examples. So this is pretty much what we are going to talk about, the inborn errors of metabolism. This is a very simple slide. Please do not think that it is a complex slide. And we have to learn everything from it. No, I'm just kidding, because this is not really what we want to learn. I learned so much from my mentor, Dr. I.C. Verma, and he always said that actually, if you want to learn to drive a car, you don't really need to know each part of the engine, etc. So you can easily drive the car without knowing everything. So that's what it is in inborn errors. So we are talking about metabolism. It is the sum total of all the chemical processes in our body by which the some complex substances are either synthesized or even broken down with a main intention of energy production as well as growth and other body functions. So inborn error of metabolism are basically those genetically inherited disorders which disrupt one or more of these pathways. So we don't really need to go into too much detail into the biochemistry. We just need to understand the basic concept, and which is, here is a substance, which is the substrate. And this has to now enter the metabolic cycle and ultimately through a series of reactions give rise to the final product P. Now, this is sometimes a simple process, sometimes a lot of intermediary steps are involved, involving crossing a few membrane barriers, etc. Now, disruption of any of this chain can give rise to a block, and that's where the problem lies. And because of this block, there could be either an accumulation of the substrate proximal to the block, or there is a deficiency of the final end product, or both. Now, because of the block, the reaction takes a turn and it goes into some other pathways where sometimes there is a production of toxic metabolites. These are the toxic. For example, we have this ammonia, which then gives rise to majority of the symptoms. So much of the intoxication types of metabolic disorder are due to this, the activation of these unusual pathways. Now, why we talk about inborn errors of metabolism is because over the years we have realized that they are really not to be ignored. They are there. We have to sit up and make note. Especially in the emergent situations and especially in the critically ill children. So there have been numerous studies, but I have only quoted a few studies where the incidence of inborn errors of metabolism could be as high as 10% in various ICUs, whether they are neonatal or pediatric. And within this group of IEMs, there could be up to 50% mortality. I know Dr. Kamath must be in the audience. One of his studies is being quoted here. Then the global birth prevalence of these IEMs has also taken note. And this is a meta-analysis that was done by Waters et al., who noted from about more than up to 50 studies were tested. And the overall prevalence was noted to be 50 per 100,000. Which means 1 in 2,000. And this is the case fatality rate, which can go even up to 33% in certain ethnic. So there is some ethnic variation as well in this prevalence, because we know that they are mostly recessive disorders, and a lot of consanguinity in certain parts of the world gives rise to an increased prevalence of these disorders. Now they do present with various types of illnesses, and they could be life-threatening as well. And they do require immediate treatment. So that's why we have to keep our eyes and ears open, because we can encounter them at any time, and there will be really no time to go ahead and first find out what it is before trying to treat the child or the patient. So one has to start the empiric treatment immediately. So if one thinks about IEM, then one starts the treatment of IEM. Now, they do provide the diagnostic and therapeutic load. It has been increasing now with the advent of so many treatment modalities that have come up, like the dietary management is now available in India, and lots of medications, etc. So the numbers of all the IEMs has also been gradually increasing. And in latest 2018 article, it was quoted to be about more than 1,000 now. So there are very many. And it is to be emphasized here that early and accurate diagnosis is really important for the best outcomes, for to start treatment early. And of course, not to forget the genetic counseling. The families need to be made aware that this is a genetically based condition and there could be a recurrence in the family. This is the onus of the pediatrician or the neonatologist or the physician who's handling the case. Now, the most crucial step in making a diagnosis is considering the possibility. It has to occur to our mind. Then only we can do further. Now, when should we start thinking of a metabolic disorder? Of course, we have some genetic clues. So whenever we face a child or an individual with an acute illness or chronic illness, the clinical pointers will come. We should always ask for a family history, whether there has been a prior occurrence of a similar disease in the family, whether there have been some unexplained deaths, whether it's a neonate or an older child, whether there is consanguinity, and sometimes even ethnic background also matters, because there are certain conditions which are more common in certain ethnic groups or geographical areas, let's say. Then other pointers could be that usually, although it's not the rule, but usually these, at least the intoxication types of IEM they do present with a prior symptom-free interval. They may not start at birth. There may be a certain time gap, which could be months, hours, even years. Then IEMs can occur at any age. We all know that. Even in the fetus, even in fetal life, one could have a presentation such as that of high drops or any arrhythmias or anything like that, or even organomegaly. Then intermittent illnesses is also a usual phenomena in these small molecules, the common IEMs. And usually the trigger, there has to be a trigger, whether it's a sepsis or fever or vomiting or starvation or some kind of a trigger, it starts the catabolic process. Any child who has an abnormal odor, whether it is from the urine or from the body or from the cerumen, it has to be taken note of, because that can be a sign of an IEM. Sometimes IEMs do present with some dysmorphic features. Say, for example, all those storage disorders, the mucopolysaccharidosis group, they do have dysmorphic features that can be easily recognized by all of us. Then, of course, unexplained deterioration. A child who's doing well suddenly becomes ill, has encephalopathy, or goes into degeneration, or has developed other neurological. These are the pointers that make us think about a genetic metabolic disorder. This is just a few examples. In the family history, when we were saying, if we draw a simple pedigree, we can get lots of clues from here. Here we see that this is a consanguineous union. You can't see the double line, but there is a double line here. And there has been a previous occurrence in the family. So this child, the previous child had died at 18 months. And he had a similar history of a liver disease, which this child has presented with. So this is a really good clue that this is could be an inborn error, or maybe a liver disease, which is genetically inherited, could be recessive disorder. And thus, our diagnosis narrows down. In this pedigree, we see that there has been a previous occurrence, but there is no consanguinity here. And there has been a maternal uncle who has a similar disorder as this boy. Now what we get the clue is that this happens in males, the females are spared, and it is maternal, it has come from maternal side. So one automatically starts thinking of an X-linked disorder. And here these two boys have developmental delay, rotatory eye movements. Rotatory eye movements are a really good clue. Of course, one needs so much more investigation, such as an MRI, complete CNS examination, etc. But to my mind, I immediately start thinking of Pelizaeus, Merzbacher, you know, like that. So pedigree is really important. It's a very simple 5 minutes exercise. It gives us a very good clue. Now, a little bit about pathophysiology. So basically, Dr. Sodhubre has been teaching us all along for the last 20 years or so about all the broad categories. So usually we classify them into three. The most important, which we encounter because they are common and we see them in our acute setups like emergency, they are the intoxication type. By intoxication, we mean that there is some intermittent a problem or accumulation of the metabolite in the body which causes a problem. So these are usually small molecule disorders, because these small molecules tend not to accumulate in the body over a period of time. Rather, they give us problems intermittently. There are a few exceptions. Of course, the number one is also an exception. PKU is a small molecule, is intoxication type. But it is not intermittent. It is a chronic, continuous sort of a process. The other disorders like organic acidemia, urea cycle because of the hyperammonemia, sugar intolerance like galactosemia, they are classic examples of intoxication types. So here again, this diagram comes in because there is accumulation of this toxic metabolite. Energy deficiency, again in this diagram, there might be a final end product which is giving rise to energy. It could be just ATP, it could be glucose. So these are the the group of disorders which are emergency types. They could be mitochondrial or cytoplasmic. Mitochondrial means all the biochemical processes that are continuing in the mitochondria. These are slightly difficult to treat and as compared to the cytoplasmic, which are due to mainly the glucose metabolism, the carbohydrate metabolism, which can be easily treated once recognized. Then the third large group is the complex molecules or the large molecule disorders or storage. They are usually these organelle problems. So like we have the mitochondria, we have the peroxisomes, we have the lysosomes, and we also have the Golgi apparatus, the endoplasmic, all these macromolecules or organelles in the body. Any problem with them is the large molecule. They're usually progressive and they do not usually present in intermittent. Now, when should we suspect in an emergency setting? Again, clinical clues, of course, at any age. Usually, of course, at least the classical types we tend to see in the early part of life, neonate and infants, but it can really be at any age. Altered sensorium, encephalopathy is the biggest group in this. That could be along with seizures, or there could be just seizures, hypotonia, ataxia, stroke-like, acute behavioral psychosis. These are all CNS symptoms. But apart from that, we know that CNS is a majority. So about 60 to 80% of all the acutely presenting will have some CNS abnormality or presentation. Then apart from that, there could be GI, there could be jaundice, liver, muscle, even kidney, blood, even cardiac, like that. So what about in the non-acute scenarios? Say, for example, we are sitting in our clinic and we do encounter so many of these children. So these are main indicators where one must suspect IEM. The first and foremost is, of course, global developmental delay. This could be associated with degeneration, without degeneration, could be have associated failure to thrive. There may not be a developmental delay. There could still be autistic features, other neurological signs, other systemic involvement, like the liver, kidney, cardiac, muscle, even eye. Along with this, you have to keep in mind our genetic pointers. One must again take the family history, draw a pedigree, and look for any similar case. Then Dr. Sodebre has guided us to so many clinical presentations, and mainly you can see that they are neurological. Mainly encephalopathy, this could be acute or chronic, then with convulsions and many metabolic derangements, which we are going to see in the later. So in acute encephalopathy, this could be encephalopathy without any other sign, or it could be with hypoglycemia, with metabolic acidosis, with seizures, or with other systemic involvement such as liver, and it could be with acidosis, etc. So this is a very simple algorithm how to approach these children who are acutely sick. Now, first, of course, we know that IEMs are not the number one diagnosis, so one has to exclude other more common diagnoses, but it has to be done side by side. It cannot be that you keep the IEMs aside, first look this, you have to do it together. So having excluded all these, or they may still be present, they could be coexisting. So one looks into, if you suspect IEM, then you can proceed and try and put them into these clinical presentation types, whether it's acidosis group, hyperammonemia, hypoglycemia, liver dysfunction, or even other. The main investigation that will guide us further in this are the basic, the GLAC, the glucose, electrolytes, lactate, liver function, acid base, ammonia, and ketone. The GLAC is a good mnemonic. So we'll just start off with a few cases because that's where the learning is. So this case number one was a very delightful little girl who presented at 10 months of age, was absolutely doing well till that time, had a normal birth, normal antenatal, had normal development, but suddenly fell ill with fever and had started having respiratory distress within a few hours or a day or so. By the time she came to the hospital in about 2 days, she was in encephalopathy and she was throwing seizures. There was no family history here. The parents were non-consanguineous. So what did we do? We did the GLAG and we noted that the child had metabolic acidosis. She also had ketosis. And this was the MRI, which shows bilateral symmetrical basal ganglia hyperintensities, showing some acute process, some intoxication type of a process. So what we did ahead was we did the metabolic investigation, the TMS and the GCMS. So some people in the audience would like to know more about this, although it's again a topic in itself, but may I just give two lines. That these are screening tests for the common metabolic disorders, which we say the common small molecule metabolic disorder, which we encounter. Now, TMS is a tandem mass spectrometry, which is usually done on a dried blood spot. It can also be done from blood or plasma or even CSF, but usual medium is the DPS, and it will look for three major groups. One is the acylcarnitines, which is meant to screen for organic acids as well as fatty acids. Now, second thing is that it also looks for amino acids, not all, a few of them. So it can give us an idea of other disorders like PKU, like tyrosinemia, like hypermethylaminemia in homocysteinuria, etc. Then the GCMS is usually done in the urine. Although this is a method and one could have many applications, but we usually do the GCMS to look at organic acids. So it gives us an organic acid profile. So that's why GCMS is a little more confirmatory and it is a little narrow. It only gives us an answer for organic acid urea, usually. Although it does give some more, like it does give orotic acid for our urea cycle. So these are good starting points. They are no longer very advanced and they are very easily available. So they must be utilized as and when you feel like. So this child underwent TMS and GCMS and got a diagnosis of propionic acidemia. So in the meantime, while we are still suspecting, we started the acute management with usual fluid electrolytes. We started giving her biotin and carnitine. We stopped her protein initially and we increased her caloric intake because this is very important because we have to stop the catabolic process. We want to give extra calories so that anabolism takes over and the offending biochemical pathway is stopped. Of course, one has to treat the intercurrent illness, whatever illness she came up with, like she had pneumonia, so that has to be treated. Then, of course, child improved and was discharged and was put on long-term dietary management and a sick regimen protocol was given. This is a little girl. So what did we see now? We saw that this child had an acute presentation of encephalopathy with metabolic acidosis. So usually we also do blood gas. So blood gas will give us an idea whether this was a normal anion gap acidosis or expanded. In normal anion gap acidosis, the acidosis is usually because of loss of bicarb. Whereas in an expanded, it is due to an addition, an accumulation of a fixed acid. Now this acid could be organic acid, which can give rise to, which we can decipher as organic aciduria, or it could be lactate, or lactic acidosis, which will take us to disorders of ketoacidosis, such as diabetes, gluconeogenetic defect, and even mitochondriopathy. Coming to case two, this was a healthy term AGA baby born in our hospital, was well till 5 years, had gone home, but the parents noted a poor feeding, progressive lethargy. And by the time on day 8 she came, he was also having seizures. There's nothing in the family here. Single term, first baby, non-consanguineous. On admission, the baby was well perfused, but very lethargic. The vitals were maintained. There was no organomegaly. In the CNS, we did see suck was poor, and there was hypotonia with brisk reflexes. This is a very important sign. The glucose was normal, so were the lactate, ammonia, blood gas, not much. So our GLAC was okay, except that something was missing, the ketones. The ketones were positive. So this was done by a simple test called DNPH, which is a chemical test. Can be done in like 5 minutes if you have the reagent in your bedside. The other investigations were normal. So what does the ketone give us a clue to? Basically, of course, the child needed the initial stabilization. We had to stop the protein because we suspected an intoxication type of IEM. Yeah, very high nutrition calories using IV nutrition initially, followed by oral and NG. Then in this case, we were suspecting a protein metabolic disorder. So protein protein was stopped, and one should increase the non-protein caloric intake, which is from glucose or carbohydrate and MCT or fats. And we have to increase the amount of calories to 125 to 140% of the normal intake. This can be achieved by increasing the GIR, and sometimes we have to use insulin so as to neutralize the glucose and not give the child an additional hyperglycemia. The fats can be infused. We use intralipid at the dose of up to 4, not many times we use 4. And of course, the intercurrent illness has to be taken care of. So in this particular baby, the TMS results came, and the leucine and isoleucine were very high in this child, along with a little bit of valine elevation. So this was all very consistent with maple syrup urine disease. So in maple syrup, we really don't have anything except that the ketosis is there. This was the urine GCMS, this was the MRI. We did corroborate with the finding. It was quite characteristic, because what it showed was there was an edema in the cerebellar white matter, in the brain stem, as well as in the internal capsule, all the midline areas, which is supposed to be myelinated. So this is edema, cerebral edema. So this child had a continuous veno-venous hemofiltration. It's very important in the acute setup to try and get rid of the toxic metabolite as early as possible. This can be done by various techniques. This is a high-end technique which may not be available everywhere, but all the neonatologists must work to start this in their own ICUs. And if not, then peritoneal dialysis is a poor alternative, which can help bring down the toxic metabolite. In this case, the leucine, isoleucine were brought down from 2200 to 500 in a matter of 7 hours. This baby went on to do well. Now, we have learned what happens in acute metabolic encephalopathy. The usual presentations are like it's a healthy term baby with uneventful pregnancy and delivery and an initial symptom-free period, but then starts to deteriorate. And if one doesn't recognize the disorder, it can continue to deteriorate. And it does not respond to the usual symptomatic treatments, say, for example, seizures, etc. They will not respond to your anticonvulsants. So it is more to do with our catabolic process. So that's why there's sometimes a relation to feeding. We often hear from pediatricians saying that we did not even start the feeds in the baby, yet the baby has deteriorated. How is that possible? But this is actually to do with just the catabolic process. The baby may not have been fed. The IV nutrition that was perhaps being given to the baby was not enough, or the baby was already in sepsis or some kind of stress which had triggered the catabolic process and hence the crisis. So as we have said, there can be a symptom-free period which can vary. So these are the basic and some advanced metabolic tests that can be done to try and detect the inborn error of metabolism. This is a big list, but of course, this is not the complete list. One can keep adding. So, like I had told you, the GLAC that comes first, the glucose, electrolytes, lactate, ammonia, and the ketone. Along with it, some very routine investigations, uric acid, liver function, kidney function, CPK, homocysteine. One must add homocysteine to the diagnostic battery because this is not, it's a simple test and it does give us a lot of information. Then we go on to, in the urine, one could do simple tests like color, the odor, the ketones, reducing substance, some chemical tests like I mentioned DNPH, they could be ferric chloride, they could be other nitrous, other tests that are available that can be done. Then in the metabolic investigations, one should do plasma amino, or at least keep the samples for plasma amino acid quantitative analysis, the TMS and the GCMS. So these are just a very few, very short list, just differentials for which disorders to think of when we have, let's say, metabolic acidosis. It gives us an indicator that it could be an organic acidopathy. It could be gluconeogenetic. This disorder is just simply treatable once you recognize that it's very rewarding. So one should keep in mind such disorders. Then glycogen storage disease, others, congenital adrenal hyperplasia as well comes in this category. Whereas if the predominant symptom is hypoglycemia, one should start thinking in terms of fatty acid oxidation or even hyperinsulinemic states, galactosemia, GSD, again FPP. Lactic acidosis takes us to mitochondriopathy as well as the GSD and HFI. Ketosis gives us the indicators for organic aciduria, again mitochondrial as well as the GSD. Hyperammonemia, as we all know, is classic for urea cycle, but also can be there in organic acidemia, mitochondrial, and fatty acid. So there's so many other disorders that this particular list of basic tests cannot detect all, but at least it covers majority. Now we come to glucose. So acute metabolic encephalopathy brought about by hypoglycemia. So why does hypoglycemia occur? We understand that hypoglycemia occurs either when the glucose production is reduced because of some defects in this pathway, such as glycogen storage, galactosemia, HFI, and fructose gluconeogenetic defects. Or it is overutilized, say for example, in hyperinsulinemia and fatty acid oxidation disorders. So a few cases on hypoglycemia. This was a 15-month-old boy who presented to us at Sir Gangaram Hospital at his fourth episode. He had a repeated episodes of vomiting, with respiratory distress, and even loss of consciousness. The family history is pretty much okay, non-consanguineous, two healthy siblings. Was well till 12 months, had normal developmental milestones. Became sick on his birthday with fever, vomiting, and loose motions. Was admitted, treated, and discharged. The similar thing happened a month later, again loose motions. This time he had some breathing difficulty, was also lethargic. But again, after admission, he was improved and discharged. At 14 months, he had a more severe episode. This time he was investigated at a bigger center. They noted metabolic acidosis. They also noted a hepatomegaly and a liver dysfunction. And he also had lethargy. This time he had a longer admission, but he improved on IV fluids and antibiotics. But since this third episode did give the pediatrician the clue that this could be an inborn error, he was alarmed and he was told to go to a bigger center as soon as another episode occurred. So this happened again exactly a month later. So they started from directly to Delhi from home, but it took 12 hours. So by the time they came, the child was really sick, lethargic, had marked respiratory distress, and he needed to be intubated and stabilized in the ICU. He was noted to have hepatomegaly, and in the investigations, he had severe metabolic acidosis, severe hyperlactatemia, liver dysfunction and also a low glucose. So his lactate pyruvate ratios were increased. This time the TMS was normal. The GCMS, however, gave the diagnosis because there was elevation of glycerol as well as glycerol 3-phosphate and some ketosis, which gave us the diagnosis in this case. So just to recapitulate, this was a recurrent episodic illness with nothing in the premorbid, and there was predominantly metabolic acidosis with some liver and lactate and hypoglycemia. So it could be a mitochondrial disorder, it could be gluconeogenetic, it could be a glycogen storage, or it could be organic aciduria. This is unlikely because we have already done the TMS and the GCMS. So the diagnosis in this case was fructose 1,6-phosphatase deficiency, and those were the pathognomonic metabolites, the glycerol and glycerol 3-phosphate. Now, this is just a very simple algorithm for hypoglycemia. Basically, we need to sample, and there are a lot of critical sampling that needs to be done in children who have recurrent hypoglycemia. So whilst we all do the bicarb, we don't do much of ketone, but beta-hydroxybutyrate is written here because this is a multinational collaborator study, lactate and free fatty acids. So once we have all in here, we see if there is no acidemia, if there is bicarbonate is normal, and even the ketosis is not there, or there is hypoketosis with reduced free fatty acids, then we are dealing with a congenital or hyperinsulinemic state. If it's a newborn, then it could even be hypopituitarism. It could be just a transient neonatal hypoglycemia or perinatal stress hyperinsulinism. If in this case, with no acidosis, if the free fatty acids are increased, which we seldom do in our setup, the diagnosis would be fatty acid oxidation defect. So practically in these two arms, how we differentiate is that any hypoglycemia, which is easily correctable by just the normal GIR of glucose, is more likely to be fatty acid oxidation. But any hypoglycemia which is resistant, which requires an increased infusion rate, then it is a hyperinsulinemic state. So that's how it is. In child who has hypoglycemia along with acidosis, then it becomes more familiar. If there is lactate, then it could be gluconeogenetic defects, or it could be also the mitochondrial. Then if there's lots of ketosis, then it could be ketotic hypoglycemia and glycogenosis, growth hormone, or even cortisol. So here I've just put a list of all the critical samples that need to be done. The first four are of course these, and then insulin. And we also should do the TMS acylcarnitines, because the fatty acid oxidation is a very major differential in this case. And the critical sample will be able to get those abnormal metabolites. Then we also should store the plasma for later on studies for these hormones. So in this list, what is most important is you should save the plasma and the urine. Again, these metabolic investigations. Now switching gears, we will go on to the hyperammonemias. This child was 12 years old and had normal development. Developed a seizure and a lethargy, an episode a month back, in which case he was admitted at a local hospital. This time he also had fever and he was managed like a regular case and was discharged in 3 days. But the seizures recurred and there was also lethargy. So the second time he was referred to Gangaram Hospital. These were the investigations that were done already before coming to the hospital. So there was some anemia. MRI had shown some mild atrophic changes with subcortical white matter changes in the T2 and flare with showing hyperintense. I don't have the picture here. There was mild hepatosplenomegaly. The liver functions were normal. And at that time, the EG had also been normal. So when the child became sick, the other investigation that already were there, The TMS had shown some increase in alanine, glycine, and ornithine, whereas the acyl-carnitine profile was normal in the TMS. On examination, we found the child to be irritable, sluggish, and he was on the third centile for his anthropometry, but the head was on the highest centile, although it was not above +2 ST. Then the tone was normal, but the reflexes were a little brisk, and the liver was palpable. So his usual investigations of GLAC, we noted the ammonia to be 133. So this was a child who was more than a year old. And so we take 80 micromoles per liter as the upper limit of normal in an infant. And above that, it comes down to 50 or 55. Amongst the other investigations, because he had hyperammonemia, we did suspect urea cycle. And we went ahead and did quantitative amino acids in the plasma. And this was done by UPLC. This can also be done by HPLC. And it showed a significant elevation of glutamine, which is a proxy biomarker for hyperammonemia. In the urine GCMS, there were non-specific metabolites. And a note was made of no orotic pain. Perhaps the child was already well at that time. Another reading of ammonia, hyperammonium was also there. So after investigations, the final diagnosis for this child was an OTC deficiency. He did turn out to have a milder variant, and that's why he was doing well till a certain period of time, and he still carries on to do all right. He's had a few more episodes, but he's doing well. So this is a classic presentation of a mild hyperammonemia, urea cycle disorder. So what I would say that the most important thing is to think about. In the first episode, when the child was managed in the other hospital, the ammonia was not done. It could have saved a lot of effort. Then we should check ammonia in all the sick babies, in the new nursery as well as in the pediatric age group. Because this hyperammonemia gives us no other clue other than encephalopathy. There is no respiratory distress, there's no acidosis, no lactate, no hypoglycemia. So one should have a high index of suspicion. Now moving on to another acute deterioration in a child who was only 5 months old. Here we see that previously the child was well, had loose motions, vomiting, fever, and then started having seizures and altered sensorium. And when he came to the hospital, he was already having abnormal posturing, which is some dystonia. There was not much in the history except that he was always noted to have a large head. I'm sure the audience has already guessed the diagnosis. So with a large head, intermittent episode with dystonia, this child has got to have some metabolic disorder. And that would be, the GLAC here was pretty okay, but it's the CT scan and the MRI that gives the diagnosis. Here we see a lot of atrophy, especially the perisylvian. So bat wing appearance and bilateral front to white matter and right external capsule. So the diagnosis was clinched on a metabolic testing, which is GCMS and the TMS. The GCMS gives the pathognomonic metabolites of glutarate and 3-hydroxyglutaric acid, along with in the TMS a note of reduced free carnitine, and the C5DC was elevated, which is glutaryl carnitine. So these are all consistent with the diagnosis of glutaric aciduria, which was proven also by genetic testing. So how was this patient managed? So initial management in this child again starts with stopping the nutrient trigger, which is protein, or you could take any other offending metabolite. In case of galactosemia, galactose. Then you give high energy, again with non-protein sources here in case of GA1. And if there is hyperammonemia, you give medications to circumvent that. If it is a very acute situation, so in hyperammonemia, we tend to go towards dialysis when the ammonia approaches 500. But latest experts have now started saying that one should start thinking even at a level as low as 300. Then the supports with vitamins, because sometimes they could turn out to be vitamin responsive disorders, and a good role of carnitine, and in some cases, glycine. The long-term management of general small molecule would be usually a dietary management where one would try to lower the levels of the offending or the dangerous metabolites, that is protein, carbohydrate, or fat, and try to balance the diet so as to give the child all that he or she needs and is able to remain in the anabolic state so as to continue with normal growth and development. So usually the organic acidemias do have a high anion gap acidosis, but it can also be there in mitochondriopathy and sometimes in gluconeogenetic defects as well. Coming to another short case, this was an 8-month-old boy who had been sick for the last 4 weeks or so with progressive lethargy and abdominal distension, also had seizures and acute gastroenteritis. He was noted at 5 months of age to have had the hepatomegaly. Okay. On family, there was consanguinity, and there was a previous girl child who had died at 16 months who had similar clinical features. So there was some hepatic dysfunction, there was encephalopathy, there was metabolic acidosis, and there was a very high lactate level in this case. So possibilities that were considered because of the consanguineous and one previous cause, we perhaps dealing with genetic and metabolic cause, there was liver dysfunction, acute deterioration, and very high lactates, which gave us the differential of maybe it's a fatty acid oxidation tyrosinemia, mitochondriopathy, urea cycle. I wouldn't put my bet on Wilson because of the age. So the final diagnosis in this child, which came around with genetic testing, was a mitochondrial DNA depletion syndrome. The child had homozygous variant, pathogenic variant in POLG gene. Another case of a 14-month-old girl who previously healthy, non-consanguineous, suddenly deteriorated with lethargy after a vaccine of measles. Now this acute illness was associated with some loss of attained milestone. So the child was admitted to our hospital. On examination, she was noted to be irritable, did not respond to any sound, had hypotonia and brisk DTRs. This suggested some CNS insult. So an MRI was done, which I will show you in a minute. And the course of this child, all that, she did gradually recover, but she has not reached her pre-morbid state yet. So she's not standing independently. She was able to speak monosyllables, but now she stopped in the middle and now she's trying to come back to her usual state. So on examination, there were some nystagmus noted. There was the power was little less on the left upper limb. The tone was decreased in all four limbs. There was wasting. The DTRs were exaggerated. The plantars were bilateral extensor. And there were no abnormal movements or contractures. In the investigation, there was mild liver dysfunction. The TMS and GCMS were pretty much okay. Electrolytes were okay. Ammonia normal. Then EEG shows diffuse cerebellar dysfunction. The BERA, there was some affection in the right ear. Left was normal. The VEP again showed some prolonged P10, P100 latencies in the left. We did the aryl sulfatase enzyme, which is normal. The lactates were a little elevated. So this was the MRI, which showed extensive bilaterally symmetrical lesions. And these all in the white matter. This is the T1. And this is the T2 weighted image, or this is the flare image, which shows almost, you know, the liquefaction of the white matter. So extensive white matter changes in this child with some cavitation as well. So in summary, this child had acute neurological presentation, had loss of milestone, with gradual regain, but not quite up to the mark. There was waxing and waning pores. There was some liver dysfunction with elevation of lactate and an MRI picture of bilateral leukoencephalopathy. Basal ganglia was also involved, I failed to show you. So a clinical, radiological, biochemical diagnosis of mitochondriopathy was thought of. And in our country, we do not have access to enzyme assays. So the only way to prove or confirm a diagnosis is by genetic testing. So that is why whole exome sequencing was ordered in this child. This was done on research basis in Manipal. And in looking at the age of the child, a mitochondriopathy could be due to a mitochondrial DNA defect, or it could be a nuclear gene defect. The younger the child, the higher the possibility of a nuclear gene defect, and thus a whole exome sequencing. So this gave us the diagnosis of a mitochondrial complex 1 disease. The child had compound heterozygous variants, pathogenic variants in this gene NDUFV1, which strongly correlates with everything, with the clinical picture as well as the MRI. This, in fact, is a common mutation in our Indian subcontinent. I think this is the last case where 4-year-old boy presented who had a pre-morbid history. He had global developmental delay starting from infancy. He had delay in walking, sitting, even speech. He also had seizure at 1 year of age and was noted to have a hyperactivity at 3.5 years, then showed regression. He started regression after three to three and a half years of age, which was mainly motor. At 4 years, he was admitted to our hospital because of sudden rise in seizures and abnormal movement. So at this time, he was evaluated. On examination, his head size was normal, but the tone as well as the DTRs were increased in this child. In the family history, non-consanguineous, but there was a family, there's in child death, who was termed as cerebral palsy with mental retardation by the earlier doctors, and there was miscarriage and on termination. So in the workup, the MRI was done, which showed bilateral periventricular hyperintensity. They were rather non-specific, but there was some mild cortical atrophy as well. So CBC was normal, so were the other investigations. So we did not get any clue. There was some perhaps elevation of lactate. We went on to do a fibroblast growth factor 21, which is very mildly elevated, again non-specific. In view of the mild white matter changes, we did a few enzyme assays, including Krabbe. They were all normal. So we did not have a diagnosis, and we had to resort to clinical exome sequencing. This is just the chromatogram, which is normal. So clinical exome sequencing showed a compound heterozygous VUS variant in MTHFR gene. Now this was termed uncertain significance because we had not done the complete investigation until that time. But looking at these two variants, this is a premature termination codon, and this is again a previously reported, very nicely established likely pathogenic variant. So we had to do some reverse post-exome workup. So we did the homocysteine, and it was very high, and that, and with a low methionine. So these two metabolites did give us a consistent picture of a severe MTHFR deficiency. Now this child is now under treatment with betaine, with only twice a month now, hydroxycobalamin and folinic acid. So in MTHFR, it is the betaine which is the mainstay of treatment and not the injections. On follow-up, he has improved, but obviously there's still deficit, and he has spasticity, but he's now learning to walk, and he does have behavioral abnormalities. His homocysteine levels are stable between 60 to 70. This is a newborn screening case, because the newborn screening was done because of the prior history of neonatal death, which had gone unexplained. So in the newborn screening, the baby was noted to have an elevated C3, which is a propionyl carnitine metabolite. and thus a suspicion of methylmalonic acidemia or propionic acidemia was made on the screening test of newborn screening, and a GCMS was done. So urine GCMS showed metabolites of methylmalonic acid and methyl citrate, which gave the direction of methylmalonic acid. So at least the child did not have propionic, it was MMA. But when the baby came to us, we did a homocysteine and noted that this was elevated. So thus, we came to a diagnosis of MMA-CHC, which is a combined methylmalonic acidemia along with hyperhomocysteinemia. So these are the two very common variants. This is the late onset variant, very prevalent in our country, as well as the worldwide, this is the most common variant, gives rise to the serious disorder. So the child has been now on treatment with injection hydroxycobalamin, carnitine, folic acid, as well as no protein restriction in this child. And these are the homocysteine levels, which have steadily been coming down. He's now on very high doses of hydroxycobalamin, but he continues to do well. So I don't have time to go ahead with the large molecule, but just one slide which gives you a picture. As you know, these are all continuously chronic sort of presentations. A large group of disorders is the lysosomal, which it consists of MPS group, DuPompe, Gaucher, Niemann-Pick, other leukodystrophies. All of these disorders can be recognized on clinical examination, radiography, some basic blood investigation, as well as enzyme assays. The enzyme assays can be done very simply on a dry blood spot as well. And this is important because staying at a remote place, you think how to send the samples. So DBS is a very good method of sending the samples, which where the metabolites are stable and the enzyme assays are very robust. The second group is peroxisomal disorders, which is again, which can be due to a global peroxisomal biogenesis disorder or the Zellweger spectrum, or it could be the functional defects of even a single enzyme, such as the bifunctional protein, etc. So a good test to detect these peroxisomal disorders is a plasma very long chain fatty acid analysis, which includes the phytanic and prostanic acid. So when in doubt, one must go ahead and order these tests. This is again done on plasma. It's preferred fasting. It should not be hemolyzed, but that's pretty much. There's not much of preparation for this. Then we all know that X-linked ALD comes in this. Then congenital disorders of glycosylation, again, a very big group, ever expanding group of disorders, and extremely difficult to identify in clinical setting, except when they have some classical features like hypotonia, cerebellar hypoplasia, abnormal fat distribution, inverted nipples, etc. So transferrin isoforms is a very good screening test, although it will not test all the disorders, but it will test at least the classic and the common ones. And mitochondrial, of course, I'm not going to touch. So to conclude, IEMs are important. They are treatable and they can be prevented as well if you do newborn screening or if you do a prenatal testing in a subsequent pregnancy in the family. It does have a wide spectrum. It from earliest like fetal or neonatal deaths to even a near normal adult who may present in very acute situations in adulthood. So we have to have a very high index of suspicion in order to catch these disorders. And to catch them is really important because we have to give them the best outcomes that can be done only if you recognize them early. So what I said is here, you do consider the common diagnosis, but side by side also test for these disorders. There is a good chance, maybe 1 in 10, that your diagnosis of metabolic disorders will come true. Also important is to store some critical samples because we all know that we cannot save all these children or babies. So at least we can make a diagnosis in them so that the family is then helped. And please do not forget to counsel the family. At least tell them to come back once to understand the disorder, to know what it is there for them in the future, because the chapter does not close by the death of the baby. And of course, there are so many treatable disorders in this group, but there are so many that are still not treatable. So one has to keep looking out for the treatment. And again, like Dr. Verma says, never miss a treatable disorder. Thank you very much.
First question is AES diagnosis as acute encephalitis syndrome diagnosis in children. How SES may help in the management?
Yeah, I saw this question because it was posed to me even prior to this presentation. And I thought a lot and I had to study a bit about this. This actually pertains to some encephalitic syndromes, which are usually infective, right? So I'm not the one. I'm not dealing with infections here. I'm basically trying to detect the inborn errors, the inherited metabolic disorders. I know that they are also genetic, but this is very, very different. The SES that you talk about is a genetic test, but it picks up the DNA or RNA of the pathogens. It has nothing to do with the child at all. So please do not confuse these two diagnostic tests. The SES has no role in inborn errors of metabolism.
Okay. How to guide treatment of treatable disorders in a resource-limited setting? Any comments on that?
I try to answer this question a little bit in my talk by giving the cases and how we manage them. Of course, we all know it is resource poor, but it has to be individualized, right? So for example, in acute situation, if we have to stop the protein and we have to continue to give the calories to the child, so there is a formula that is now available. It's a protein-free formula. But if you do not have access to that, don't worry. You can give glucose, you can give MCT, you can give ghee, you can give those indigenous measures so that the child continues to get those calories. And you can talk to us, you can talk to any expert and they will give you an idea.
Okay. Ideal sampling of urine for organic aciduria.
Yeah, like for all metabolic testing, it has to be a reasonably concentrated sample. It should be sterile, shouldn't be full of bacteria. So first morning sample of urine is what we tend to say, but it is more important that the sample is collected in these intermittently sick child, in the episode when the child is actually sick. So that gives us the highest chance of picking those abnormal metabolites. That's all. And if you're sending from a remote area, you should first talk to the laboratory and get all the information, and then maybe for the stability purpose, put it on a filter paper. You know, those newborn screening filter cards are thick enough to soak in the urine metabolites as well. It cannot be an ordinary filter paper. It has to be this grade, newborn screening grade. So you can send the sample on a filter paper as well. But make sure that it is reasonably dry before you ship it.
Okay. GCMS, TMS efficacy in determining inborn errors of metabolism.
Yes. So we know inborn errors of metabolism is much more than what is detected by just these two tests. But for practical reasons, for screening purpose, these are really good tests because it gives us at least those common genetic metabolic disorders where we can do something. Because whatever is screened for in these two disorders, they are mostly treatable. So one must go ahead and do this if you are suspecting a metabolic disorder.
Okay, so we've got a lot of questions from the live audience. Okay. So I invite Dr. Sheetal, if she could choose some of the relevant questions and address it to Dr. Sure. Smita in the interest of time, because there are quite a few questions that we've received. Okay. Dr. Sheetal.
Good evening, Dr. Sunita. It's always a pleasure to hear you.
Yeah. Hi, Sheetal. How are you?
Wonderful presentation. And I can see the number of questions.
Oh my God.
I don't think so. I can shortlist right now, but okay. I'll just go through them. Many of them would be repeats. But if you can just, you know, in one or two lines, if you can just answer the queries.
Okay.
The first is role of genetic testing in MMA. I think you will be taking this tomorrow. Sorry, in the next session, the genetic.
Yeah, testing. I will, but I may clarify here. So yeah. MMA is not one disease. Of yes. course, one could think. I gave an example here of a child who was screened by newborn screening. And would have gone ahead with treatment of MMA, that is isolated MMA, but we changed his diagnosis to MMA-CHC because it was the hyperhomocysteinemia which was there along with it. So that changes the treatment. True. Whereas you do protein restrict in isolated MMA, you do not protein restrict in MMA-CHC. So that's why it's important to do genetic testing to get your accurate diagnosis and for future, for carrier testing, for prenatal diagnosis. Because prenatal here is can only be done via genetic testing.
So the next question is, they have asked a common IEM presenting with rotatory eye movement. You said that eye movements are a clue. So probably
yes.
they just want to know some common
IEMs. I'm not sure what common, but I can just think of that Pelizaeus-Merzbacher disease.
Yeah.
And a lot of cerebellar hypoplastic syndromes, they would have nystagmus. You know.
Okay, so this is one more question. That for MSUD during urination, the urine usually start smelling like maple syrup, that's what they say. So can we consider the same as the first point of suspicion before doing any sort of confirmatory test? That was the question.
Well, it is right, but in my 19 years of experience, I haven't been able to smell any urine. It's more easy to do a DNPH test.
Excellent. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. So, another question is whether we require to do GCMS or the same can be done by LCMS also.
So, there are two modalities and with some overlap. So, yeah. LCMS is a more advanced technique and yes, it can pick up a lot. But GCMS for organic acids, if you were to check for those the pathognomonic metabolite, you do need the GCMS.
Okay, so if we are giving an option, then we would, like for a screening, I think GCMS...
The LCMS is good. It is better for screening because it is broader and it is more accurate.
Okay, so the next is, can starvation ketosis present with acidosis and encephalopathy? Then how should we differentiate it, whether it is just starvation ketosis or it is metabolic? So,
the metabolic disorders that present with ketosis are actually an extension of a normal physiological process only.
Right.
So, if a person presents with starvation ketosis, but has crossed the boundaries and has not, so he could go ahead and present with this acidosis. I mean, it is all the same, except that there is no underlying inherited change.
From Dr. Sood, I think he also has said the same thing, that what is the practical significance of abnormal urine odors? Because you know, there is a lot of list of different disorders, but in clinical practice, usually, you know, boiled cabbage or maple syrup, and he's probably correlating what we have said, that we really don't know how these smells like. So should we depend on them for diagnosis?
So, well, we should keep talking about them because it may come in handy anytime. Although we do have so many other investigations to back our diagnosis.
But just like color of urine, the smell of urine.
Yeah. They're very basic and we should know about them.
Yeah, right. Thank you, ma'am. So in newborns, most of the times, TMS, GCM is negative in the setting of a strong suspicion of IEM. How to manage and how to follow up and when to repeat the test. This is from Dr. Karthikeyan.
So he's right that we may not pick all the disorders in this, but it's your clinical presentation that will guide you. And a list of other investigations that I had added like, you know, the basic uric acid, the liver function, the lactate. These are very, really important to give us a clue. It's not just the TMS and the GCMS. So many, like the neurotransmitter disorders are there, which are metabolic and they are treatable as well. But you will not find, you may not find anything on TMS and GCMS. So you have to just open your, broader your differentials.
Moreover, you're working on the critical window when exactly you're taking the sample. So
yes, absolutely. You may miss it. Yes.
You might not get a very ideal TMS, GCMS in the first go. So you might, the ideal situation, the critical time is very important for sending any test for metabolites, TMS, GCMS, anything. You know, after correction of the acute state, if you're sending it, you might turn up to having a negative report.
Yes, absolutely. Like a very simple case of glycogen storage disease type 1. The child will present with acidosis, there will be hypoglycemia, there will be bicarb, which is very low, but you start thinking of organic acidemia, but you will not find anything in the TMS and the GCMS. Right. So you have to start thinking of GSD, then only you do your ketones, you do other, your hyper fasting studies, then only you'll get to diagnosis.
Okay, so another question from Dr. Vikrant is, can urine ketones be a substitute for blood ketones for workup for unexplained hypoglycemia? He says this is not routinely available in labs.
Although it's not a very difficult assay to do, but majority of the biochemistry labs are not doing it because not many people are asking for it. So obviously we have been doing without the blood free fatty acids or ketones. So it's not, I cannot say that it is not necessary, but one can go ahead even without that, keeping in mind that urine ketones at least are available.
Okay, so this is from Dr. Metabolic encephalopathies be mistaken for perinatal hypoxia encephalopathy. Is it mandatory to do metabolic screening all cases with encephalopathy?
Yes, it is mandatory because you never know. You can have a baby who has metabolic disorder who also had perinatal asphyxia. Yeah, there is no defining line, is there? So you should do it.
Because of the metabolic abnormality, he had an hypoxic event. You don't know, right?
Yeah, it could be the other way around. Yes.
So please explain how to manage isolated hyperammonemia with normal tests, follow-up and management.
Hyperammonemia with normal
tests? Probably the GCMS, TMS or the other follow-up tests were normal. So how do we follow up such a child with isolated hyperammonemia?
Yes. So usually if it is a child with recurrent or chronic hyperammonemia whom you are suspecting to have some inherited disorder, because as you know, there are certain acquired conditions as well. So if you're thinking in terms of inherited metabolic disorder, then it may not be possible. It may not be always possible to have an abnormality in the TMS. So what we do is we check for two things. We look for orotic acid in the urine by the GCMS, because the laboratory may not be knowing that you are looking for this metabolite. Secondly, we do plasma amino acids, quantitative, because we want to look at each and every amino acid and see not only the elevated levels, but also the low levels. See, for example, in OTC, it's not important, not necessary that the ornithine be elevated. It is more consistent to have a low citrulline. So that's why even a lower levels of amino acids are important. And that will only show up in the plasma amino acid because it is more accurate. So again, there are the proximal urea cycle disorders do not have any derangements in the amino acid, etc., except for the glutamine. So, and glutamine may not be picked on TMS. Certain TMSs only do 8 amino acids, which does not include glutamine. So, yes, you can miss urea cycle defect with a normal TMS.
What is the practical significance of lactate pyruvate ratio in evaluation of a case of hyperlactatemia? Does it usually help in pointing towards a diagnosis? And also, if there is a high lactate but normal pH, my God, these are too many things. Ma'am, you have to note them. So,
So it's okay. It's a very good question, and it's very pertinent because we also do not do pyruvate in our hospital, and we have been able to survive. So what I would say is that lactate pyruvate ratio should only be done if the lactate is increased. It has no significance if there is no high lactate. Number one. Number two is its practical significance lies only in the PDH, the pyruvate dehydrogenase, so deficiency. So that's why if you are anyway suspecting that, you could go ahead with genetic testing. Because I know it is very tedious and it is also a little expensive to just get a clue. It's not even a diagnostic test. So one could do without it. And yes, it is possible to have a high lactate with a normal bicarb, because that's the chronic state of hyperlactatemia, where the body has normalized its other metabolites, but the lactate continues to be high. This is a very common scenario in our mitochondriopathies.
Right. So another is same, that ammonia is raised, but DCMS, TMS, I think we have...
It's the same, isn't it? Yeah. We can miss the orotic acid, like you said, Sheetal, that if you do not catch a sample in the critical time, then it may not show the elevated metabolite. So right. The GCMS in hyperammonemia, for me, other than organic acidemias, I will also look for orotic acid, and it may not be elevated. We have seen a practical case, I showed you.
Yes, Dr. Soumya is asking for a basic book to start studying for IEM for an obstetrician. Can you suggest any reference book, ma'am?
It's not a really, it is a book, but it's more easy to get it on an app. So the app is called EVM. Many of you already know about this. So this is the book called Vademecum Metabolicum.
So, which temperature is required to store urine for further testing?
Which temperature?
Yeah.
Best is to freeze it. Best is to freeze it because that gives you the longest stability.
Okay. But transportation would be difficult. So, they will have to send it in. So, does GCMS has, I'm not able to understand this question, but does GCMS have an installed library to confirm metabolite?
Yes. So there are libraries that you can refer to if you want to deduce or try and detect which metabolite you are looking up as in your chromatogram. So yes, you can find them. It is usually given by the companies who sell the equipment, mm-hmm. but it can also be obtained from elsewhere.
Okay. So next question is again, I think, it can be taken next time, that if it is GCMS, TMS shows glutaric aciduria, but clinical exome is normal, how to approach further? So you would like to take it now or in the next?
Yeah, I can take it now because I have gone through this myself and I'm still, you know, struggling with it. We know that genetic testing will not give an answer in 100% of the cases. So because we know that there are so many deep intronic, there are several answers to that. So up until now, we consider these metabolites as pathognomonic. So if you have a child who has clinical features fitting in with your diagnosis, and you have these metabolites which are authentic, and you think that they are not spurious, then your diagnosis will remain the same. The only caveat here is the glutaric aciduria type 3. Type 3 is the one where you can get the glutarate and 3-hydroxyglutarate in the GCMS. It's a benign entity. There is another gene for that. You might just want to look at that gene to settle that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sunita, for that very insightful presentation. I think the audience has really appreciated it. We got a lot of appreciating messages in the chat window, thanking you for the very precise and very detailed explanations that you've given us. And I just wanted to remind the audience that we have part two of this series coming up on the 12th of May at the same time, 4 p.m. We will be discussing more in depth about the use of next generation sequencing in the diagnosis of inborn errors of metabolism. So if your friends haven't signed up for the webinar, please ask them to sign up. We'll send out the link again. And if you have any additional queries, as Dr. Sheetal mentioned, you can always write in to us at diagnostics@medgenome.com or give us a call on our toll-free number 1-800-103-3691. And we will also be sending out a link to the recording of this webinar in a couple of days. And so you can go back and revisit the talk whenever you're free. So once again, so thank you very much, Dr. Sunita, for taking time off and giving us this very excellent.
Thank you so much, Medgenome, and thank you, Joseph. Thank you, Sheetal.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Sheetal.